How you doing, everybody?
Great.
Yeah, make some noise. It's too early for us.
So we're here to talk about the different aspects of the business, really, from all different perspectives. Does anyone have a question to start? Hi, guys.
Hello. I have two questions, if that's okay. My first is, how much of your job behind the microphone involves improv work? And if you've ever done improv, what's your favorite sort of line that you've done and that they've put in?
I would say, just really, I'll be brief because I talk way too much. I think very little of it, and from my perspective, involves improv. There are times, though, where you know, depending on your relationship with the director and how long you've been working on that particular project, that you'll throw in extra things. Sometimes when you think that a line is going to be short or not that, you'll add extra stuff just to see what happens. But I don't really have anything. I'll try to think of something that was interesting. I'm a really boring person.
I think in anime, it's, you know, you can't ad-lib a whole lot because you've got a script, obviously, and it's hopefully been written appropriately that it matches, and it has to match. You can't veer off because it's, you know. But in video games, I think you get a lot more leeway. And I know there was a video game I did, Borderlands 2, and we did a lot of improv, and unfortunately my favorite line in the world did not make it into the game. So. And I would say it, but I think it's probably for an 18 or older panel.
Is that why it didn't make
That's
it to
probably
the end?
Why it didn't make it
Well, yeah, but you know what's funny? It didn't make it in, but so many other things did. I'm like, why didn't my line make
that?
It? Why didn't that line make it in? You know, it's like, really, you're differentiating? But it was, you don't really get a whole lot of time. And the other, I would say, if you do improv, it's sort of like maybe if there's going to be extras on the DVD or something, you know, outtakes, things like that, or Easter eggs and stuff like that you can do.
I did one entirely improv, and that was a Monajaku in Ghost Stories, which they just said, okay, here's what you kind of have to say, but just make it up. And
that's cool. That's
it was
really
a bad Jack Nicholson impersonation, and completely improv.
You ever had this happen where you, you'll be doing a line, and it's kind of a lengthy line, and you mess it up. So, but you verbalize your mess ups. You're like going, you know, I said we have to get in there and get. Oh, son of a bitch! God damn it! And it fits, and, you know. And they're like, well, we'll just keep that for fun, you know.
Yeah.
But it, you know, it's just one of those things.
And then my second question is kind of personal. I hope that's okay. I've personally been interested in voice acting for a really long time. I'm currently taking acting classes. I've done a little bit of commercial work. I'm wondering if you have any advice for kind of breaking into the business or getting auditions and succeeding at getting booking.
I think I can. Are you? Do you find yourself you're pretty good at it? Do you think you're okay at doing it?
I think I'm.
Okay, then don't
get
into the business. We have enough competition already. All right.
I mean, I suck. Never mind.
But no, you can get in. You can be competing. I got to compete with these guys. You can compete against the girl. That'll be fine. If you take her work, I don't care. Any guys out here with a voice that sounds like this,
I'm
get out of
right
the business
here.
Now.
right here. Yeah. Go ahead, guys. I don't want to always. I'm sorry.
You know, I think the thing to do is no matter what you want to do as a career or, you know, you want to follow your passion, you want to immerse yourself in, get a, I did a lot of volunteer things. I read for the blind. Things that took not improv skills but sight reading so that you could read things right away and not have to think about it but you're still in the moment. I used to be a reader for auditions, so I played many characters all at once without thinking about me but thinking about how do I serve my scene partner. You want to do as much as you can to get as many skills as you can because you want your suitcase, whatever, if you're an artist or a dancer, a singer, actor, suitcase is packed full with those skills. So when that door opens, you just walk through. Yeah. You don't have to think about it. You don't have to worry. You just go. And then you keep learning and learning along the way. But do everything you can, even if it's getting a job at the movie theater, you're still working within your business. Surround yourself with great people. They keep you at your best.
And three words you must never, ever forget. Thrive on rejection.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. I think that was all that's really well said. I think what you're doing already, from what you said, I think is the right way to start, is get some acting training, have some acting background, some foundation. And then you can, you know, because acting is acting. I mean, there are different ways that you filter that talent or that muscle, you know, on camera versus in a studio or in a booth versus on stage or whatever. But yeah, getting that foundation, and I think that toolbox analogy is great, so that when there is an opportunity, you're ready to take it. And, you know, what we do the majority of the time is just flat out cold readings, right? We are able to take a line and put some type of, not just read it without messing it up, but put some point of view behind it, put some character behind it. And we do that on the spot. And so if you come in, and so you want to be ready to be able to do that, because what you don't want to do is get that opportunity, and then, you know, it can be hard to, if you, you know, put yourself in a bad light, it's hard to kind of, you know, get back to that place. Yeah.
And I would to add to what Veronica and David just said, and this I think falls in line with it, is that this is a job, it's work. The work of acting is finding the job. The job is the payoff for the work you've done, the classes, right. The studying, the marketing, the connections, the meetings, all that stuff is all leading up. So when you get that opportunity, you're completely and fully prepared, because like David just said, if you blow it, that's what they remember. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's like,
exactly.
Oh yeah, but Swayze, no, he's no good. Yeah. We had him in there last week. So,
and, you know, the constant rejection thing too. I mean, you kind of have to be a tiny bit of a masochist. I mean, I always, when I walk into a room for the first time, I always kind of just chuckle to myself with the thought, like, wow, I'm still doing this. I'm asking people to, judge me. I'm asking to stand up in front of people and be judged, you know? But if you love it, you love it. It's kind of a labor of love in that way, I think.
And what's also weird in this business, you cannot get a job, right? And in any other line of work in America, if you didn't get hired because of that, you could sue them. You know what I mean?
Oh, sure.
It's like, I'm sorry, you're not black enough.
Right.
What? Well, it's the truth. I mean, they're looking for a particular type, and that's what the script calls for.
That's a really good point.
And that's it.
You know, you could do something, and I recommend this. You can bypass all of this. Go find an anime in Japan and buy the North American distribution rights.
And cast
and record it yourself. And then just bypass all this nonsense.
I did not think
that's a
of
great
that.
Idea.
That's a great idea.
And we'll come work for you.
Yeah,
you can hire us.
Yeah, you can hire us. The other thing is, you're constantly, very few people, even if you move from job to job, you know, you have periods of time, maybe even a couple years or longer, that you're not interviewing for a job. No matter what level you're at this business, from, you know, someone who's just starting to someone really established who's a star and a name, you're always looking for a job. And that's kind of just the reality of it.
And you know what's beautiful is in voice acting, it's the only form of acting in which a guy like Matranga and I could be up for the same role. In no other acting would he and I be competing for the same role. But voice acting comes down to who can say, launch the missiles now, better. And he's much better looking than me, but yeah. I'm way more talented.
They don't think so.
Okay, so I would like to unpack my suitcase a little bit. Hi, I'm Aaron.
Hi.
And currently I'm about to graduate with music composition and theater degrees.
Cool.
And so I was sort of wondering, there's a lot of stickers on my suitcase going to many destinations. And I'm trying to figure out if there's some sort of way I can have a route that connects all of those places that I would like to sort of go and I sort of see myself at. How fluid is the industry that you can sort of be able to
do that?
Do that. Yeah. You know, be
an actor. I would recommend buying the North American distribution rights to an anime.
You mean,
and then you can do whatever the hell you want.
Combining,
it's that easy.
Combining
money solves
skills.
Every problem.
No, but like Joe,
every
what's your path been?
Well, that's interesting because I came to anime. I was in music production. had a studio, met with a man who wanted, I didn't even know what anime was when he came in the office. Wow. sorry, God, I didn't mean to. But he was such a cool guy, and he seemed so interesting that I said, let's look into this, and we did Record of Lotus War. That was the first title. And then we were going to become partners. One thing led to another. I met the man who actually started this whole con back in 1999, I guess it was. And that led to a whole bunch of work. So I had no idea I was even going to be doing this. But once I got on that train, I wanted to do it really well. So I got specialized software because the new Star Wars movies were coming out. I apologize for that, by the way. But I found out the software they used was very advanced. It allowed you to basically type a script into the computer and click a line on the script and the whole thing would synchronize to that moment, which meant I could get a lot more work done and the actors could spend more time acting. So yeah, this I actually think that you're on the right path there. You have to have a really big suitcase today because there's not a lot of work in any of the various fields. Like technically my general area would be called post-production. So I've done work for movies, for television shows, for anime, and I'm an active musician, I play in bands. All of that together, and I almost have my rent every month. So, but you have boom periods. There was a period between 2002 and 2007 where there was a tremendous amount of work in New York, and I was getting most of it. So you have to be ready. You have to prepare for the hard times after the good times. And as Kathleen said, you just always have to be ready. You have to be able to do whatever somebody just called you about well.
The thing is, when you have so many talents, and we all need to develop as many as we can, but you don't know what's going to come up. And as you start on your journey this way, it could turn this way. And as Joe said, you know, you started in music, then you opened a studio, and then you were doing movies, and then anime. Like it all, at age 10, at age 23, you never knew what was going
to
happen.
I didn't even plan to open a studio.
Yeah,
so I was working in other people's studio and I saw some place really cheap and I said, I'll take that. It's better than storing the gear in the storage room. It's all very strange.
So the thing is, you may not, I think it's always good to have goals, but you may not know exactly what the path is going to be to get there. So I don't think there's one set way. I hope it's my agent calling.
That's Martin Scorsese on the phone.
No, just my mother.
I think too,
that is your
what agent. A disappointment.
Martin Scorsese is yes. Your mother.
I think too that the thing that's different than you know when I was first starting, which I hope is adding to what was just said. I think everything that was said is spot on. Is that now content is king, right? And there are so many ways now that you can create your own content and literally be taken seriously now with that. And so the more diversification you have, it's kind of like a stock portfolio. You know, you're going to do better if you've got things. You own shares in different areas. And so, you know, with all of the skills that you're acquiring and have, you can do a lot with that in creating your own content. And at the end of the day, now, you know, in New York and LA, what speaks is not, oh, hey, look, I've got a bunch of money or I've got a bunch of backers. It's, hey, I've already got this content. I've already got this thing developed and I've already got people, followers that are interested in it here. And they want to.
When we develop, and still are, but we developed this little cartoon and ran into David Harris. Remember David?
Yeah.
I was at coming back from a convention in Rochester, New York, and I changed planes in Newark, and I was like walking down the through the airport, and I was like, I know that guy. And I was like, David? And he's like, oh, hey, you know, what are you doing? And he goes, I just came back from Rochester. And he goes, so did I. And he had just gotten married. He was on his way to Maui or to Bali or Bora Bora or something, I don't know, for his honeymoon. But anyway, we got to talking and stuff, and I we stayed in touch via email, and I told him about this idea we were working on, and he goes, yeah, send it to me. I'd love to see it. And we sent it to him. It was very rough. We had animated some of it and you know and all this stuff, but it wasn't completely finished. And he said, well, this is great. This is hilarious. What you ought to do is put it up on YouTube and see if you get some traction. And we're like, oh, okay. Because the answer we were hoping to get was, yeah, and he, oh, by the way, I should mention, he worked in new acquisitions for MTV. So he was in the business of finding things and putting them on TV. And he told us that, he goes, you know, John, the days of writing a check to develop it is over. He goes, they look for stuff that's on YouTube and whatever platform it is that's already got traction because they know that will make money. They don't have to take the risk. So what David said is absolutely true. And unfortunately, we live in a place now, or in a time and an environment where you can do that, you know, develop it and put it up there yourself.
Yeah, I should add one thing. You have to be really honest with yourself about what you're good at. Because if you over-diversify and you're actually only good at half of the things you're putting out there, people are going to figure that out.
That's a brilliant comment.
It's very important.
That's true.
There are some people who are really brilliant at, like David Bowie was an actor and a musician and a writer and a comedian too. I mean, he was everything. Not everybody is that diverse, you know. If you're really good at only one thing, then you just have to work harder in that market to find work, you know. But I was just restless, you know. And music is tough. Music is very hard alone. And what he's saying about content is completely true now, especially in music, you know. But you have to pitch it all. Like, the risk level changes. Like, if you're an actor, you're looking to be paid to act. If you're trying to pitch content, now you're out there with other people, so you're going to spend your own money to create what's called a sizzle, which is like a demo reel. You may make 30 of them before anybody pays any attention to you. Right. So you have to be ready for that. You don't need a lot of money, in my opinion. I have a friend who got an Academy Award nomination on a video they submitted. It was on a DV camera that he bought in like JCPenney in the year 2001. I mean, it was unbelievable. And have you seen Bat Dad on, it's going around Facebook? I mean, Bat Dad has something like 4 million views. It's a man with a Batman mask basically torturing his wife and driving her crazy. I mean, but it's brilliant. I mean, I'm looking at it. I think this could be done on a real budget. So.
And from a production standpoint, I think we live in a time now where you can do a lot more for less money, but you have a lot less opportunity to make money. Because so many people can do it, and there's so much content out there. I mean, there's 40 billion YouTube videos, and that's one of the realities of the world.
You know what you do? Was it Radiohead that did that? They put their album out on their website for download and said it's free, and if you want to donate anything, you can. They totally stuck it to the record company. Right. They gave away their music and said, here's a donation button, and they made like 10 times what they would have made if they would have sold it. Based on what, because people were like, that's so cool, I'll give you $100. Even though, you know, you would have bought it for 15.
Louis C.K. did something similar to that too, right?
Yeah.
Where he released one of his specials for $5 on his website instead of, you know, whatever else you were gonna pay for. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the funny thing about the Radiohead thing is chance came into play because their agent told them that about 5 months before they released that, the agent actually advised them to change careers. This is Radiohead. They said, we don't think you've got anything going on. They decided to emulate something that Nine Inch Nails did. The difference was when they decided to do it, by a coincidence, 2 weeks before, the New York Times writer that week happened to be a Radiohead fan.
Wow.
So he talked about it. And if it weren't for that bizarre coincidence of publicity, who knows what would have happened.
And chance comes into play almost always. When you have an opportunity that is a break or something that moves you forward, there's usually an element of chance in there, or an element of being at the right place at the right time, or an old contact pays off. I mean, I did a voiceover demo, and it wasn't until 6 years after I made that demo that I did anything in anime or voiceover work.
That's why that comment about embracing rejection, it's a big deal because there's a lot of chance involved in all of this. You have to have talent, you have to be lucky. There's one thing that's absolutely sure. If you never take any chances because of a fear of rejection, your odds drop almost astronomically. Because think about it, if you're going to fail at 90% of the things you're doing, then when is that moment gonna come where the one that makes it all work happens?
It's like Powerball.
Exactly.
Yeah. Someone's
got to
win.
Although the odds are really
in fact, the
yeah,
money
but,
you,
but
the money you would
wins.
Spend on acting
someone
classes, just go buy lotto tickets.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. I mean, they do say it's kind of like playing the lottery with your life, or your career at least.
And then the other thing, too, that reminds me of what you just said, Joe, is I remember my first audition, and I mean, I want to think it was with you at ADV. And it was like an open audition.
Probably, yeah. And it was cattle call.
Yeah, and I came in, and you know, and I had been doing quite a bit of voice work already, commercials and that sort of thing, and I, you know, thought I was pretty hot stuff, and of course I wasn't. But I came into their studio, I had no idea what anime was, this is 1996, and I came in to this, do this stuff thinking I was just going to blow these guys away. And I had no idea, so they're like, you know, David is going, okay, so here's your script, and when you see the Japanese, when you hear the Japanese, you'll start talking. I was like, okay. So they roll the camera, roll the video, and I'm like looking at it, just going. You're like, okay, John, that's when you start talking. Oh, okay. I mean, that went on for like 10 minutes, and I still didn't get it. And I think they were like very kind, well, thanks for coming in, that was great.
Yeah, I don't think you scored very high
But this is the other thing that rejection, all these things, but it also takes an incredible amount of tenacity. So I went to my car and I sat there and I thought, oh my God, that was the worst audition I've ever had. I failed epically. And so I went back in and I said, I know you guys have other people, but when you get the chance, I'd like to do it again, please. And they said, okay, they were very gracious, and I sat there for like an hour waiting, and I went back in, and I just kind of, you know, took the lid off and went balls to the wall, pardon my expression, but just started doing weird voices and all this, and it was enough for them to go, okay, all right, well, that was better. So ended up getting a small part in a show. And then that led to another small part, which led to another small part, which led to a like slightly larger part, and it just kind of went on and on and on. And I talk about chance. I mean, I happened to be in Houston, Texas, in 1996, as this little company called ADV had planted itself and ended up becoming the largest distributor of anime in North America, and provided more work for Houston actors than anybody ever, yep, including the Alley. I mean, it's just like, it was an amazing time.
I'll say that he did not do well on his initial audition at all. He did not have any high
hopes. Yeah, we've covered that, thank
but,
you.
But since then, I mentioned this to him last night, if I had to direct a show and they only allowed me to have one male actor for everybody in that show, I could only have one, I would pick John because he has a phenomenal range.
Thank you.
You can do anybody.
Wow. You know, we're in the room, man.
No. Hello. Rob, yeah, no. John's got the part. You guys are.
Again, I don't mean
it's to. It's all right, Rob. You're going to go to Japan and buy a company, right?
Yeah,
and
that's right. He's going
to
go buy the
I don't
company.
Mean to beat a dead horse, but just buy the North American rights. You know, do it yourself. Sadly, all this is nonsense.
Sadly, all of everything we've all said, I think that's probably the best way to go about it. Yeah.
You've got about as much of a chance.
And if you win the lotto, you can do that.
Yeah, right.
This is for Ronica. I loved your role in Seven of Seven as Nana.
Oh, thank you.
How did you remember to do all seven Nanas? Was that harder?
Actually, most dubbing, we do each character all the way through the show and then come back and do the next character. So Nana Seven of Seven, I played actually eight of the Nanas in that show. And we basically did all of them. We had a vocal reference so we could go back, but one was happy, one was sad, one was angry, and things like that, like the seven dwarves, really. And so, but taller, not that much taller. I could kind of follow it through, and Sean Schemmel, he directed it, and he was really great about keeping on top of that, and we had a really great time working on it. It's fun to play all the characters, I have to say.
Does anyone else have a question?
Okay. Sprint.
Hello. I have severe anxiety disorder. And recently I've gotten a lot better, but I want to know, do you guys have any advice for how I can conquer that? Because I want to translate for anime.
You want to translate for anime?
Yeah. And I just don't want to let my fear get in the way of my dreams.
Well, that's the best way to start, is to know that you don't want to let your fear block you from your life and what you want to do. I feel like you're on the right track, knowing that and speaking that out loud. And it sounds like you're taking steps to deal with that. I think, I mean, I deal with anxiety, you know, of my own, social anxiety, things like that. I've kind of used humor and things like that to get around it. I don't know, that's hard to answer. It's different for everybody, but I think there are things you can do. Even there are some people that do some acting training, not to be an actor particularly, but to just give them some confidence in you know, being up in front of people or expressing themselves. Where do you live? Oh, really? No, Louisville, Kentucky.
Louisville, Kentucky?
One of the best regional theaters in the country is in Louisville, Kentucky, Actors Theater of Louisville. I actually spent 10 months there in 99, 2000. So there are I know of that region, and there are acting classes there for beginners or even for non-professionals, you know, things like that. Google that. I'm sure that there are
things there. Yeah, if you Google acting classes in Louisville, you will get a plethora of things to pop up. And then what I would do is contact them and tell them kind of what your goal is, you know. Tell them what you're trying to accomplish and make sure that it's a good fit for what you want to do. But that would be great. David's right. A lot of people take acting classes to overcome all kinds of fears and issues or help strengthen them in areas. And they're not necessarily trying to be an actor, but it just gives them a level of confidence that, you know.
And I would recommend buying the North American rights to and that way you can boss around actors all day and
that's
you can
right.
feel like a big shot. And that will eliminate a lot of anxiety. I find that works for me.
Own the world.
And I'd like to add, you'd be amazed how many people in all of entertainment actually suffer from severe anxiety. And they do a very good job of not letting it, I don't know how to put this properly, not letting it be known. Not that they're ashamed, but they don't want the energy of it to interfere with their own momentum. So it's important to know that you're not alone. Like, huge stars have this, and they've dealt with someone from Saturday Night Live, I can't remember which actor it was, actually wrote an entire book about this topic.
Oh, yeah.
That was,
what's her name?
He was a blonde actor. So the interesting thing on that is, not only did he have the problem, he's on live television every day. Can you imagine that? So that's a level of...
An SNL?
The pressure? Oh my God.
Yeah. Having to memorize scripts, go live on the air. So the interesting thing is that, I think it was Mike Tyson who said, everybody's afraid. It's the ones who actually continue to move forward with the fear that have the potential for a better life. So you're not alone, don't worry.
Actually, what he said was, everybody's afraid until they keep that moving forward.
Mike Tyson, ladies.
Everybody's afraid of me because I'm going to bite their ear off.
The only flaw in his logic is that you need a few million dollars to do what he's talking about.
Right,
so
right.
If we all group together, we could maybe rise up and then we can buy his license out and do a hostile takeover at some point.
But exactly.
I'd be happy to sell out to everybody. Y'all want to get up a few million dollars, come buy us out? We're more than happy.
You see, that's what happens. Once you have it, then you sell it. It's a cycle. It's a brand.
Yeah.
You know,
I can tell you, if you get together enough money, we will be happy to sell out.
We can't wait to buy it. They can't wait to sell it. It's an amazing symbiotic.
I mean, we live in the age of Kickstarter. We can make this happen.
I think ultimately acting is about talking and listening, but being human is about listening. And when you're able to listen and realize it's not about you, it's about others, it also helps to take the anxiety off. Because a lot of anxiety, in general, is about the fear of people looking at you, about it being about you, but it's not. It's about us. And I think when we all can kind of take it away from us and think about us, or take it away from me and think about us, it relieves that stress some.
And I think, you know, if you train as an actor, and there are different mediums that are more self-centric than others, but I agree with that. It's about the person that you're in a scene with. It's not really about you, you know? Your focus, a lot of acting methodologies and ideologies are about, you know, putting your energy and focus on the other person and listening and being present.
So good luck.
So in your panel earlier, I happened to catch it, and I don't know exactly what you were talking about. So, but
neither did I.
Yeah. You're some rumble, blah, 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 blah.
Yes, it's similar to Mal.
No, you were talking about doing this Shakespeare thing, and you had the lines, and they had the line up before your line.
Oh, unrehearsed Shakespeare.
Unrehearsed Shakespeare. And it caused you to really listen to what's going on in the scene. And so when you see, you're listening. So when you hear or see that line, you know this is your line. But if you're not paying attention, because I had an acting teacher in college tell me that 99% of acting is just reacting. And you know, if you're not engaged in listening to what the other person is doing or what's going on, if you're in it just to go, I'm going to do my little thing now, you know, it's no good.
And that's how Shakespeare's actors did it. I mean, back in the day, you know, they didn't have the whole play. They only got their lines. Their scroll, exactly. And they got their cue line. So literally they were waiting in the wings, listening for that line so that they knew that that's when they were supposed to go and be out there.
Yep.
Which created, just like John said, a really active, engaged listening.
And on a day-to-day basis, to get over anxiety, just realize most people are garbage and you're better than any of them. That's what I do. I couldn't give less of a damn.
Is it working?
We're right here, dude.
I know. Yeah, y'all, you guys are great. Smile.
I mean, none of us are having dinner with you, so
You're wanting to be a translator, right? Have you, how are your skills? Have you gone taking classes? Have you learned? Okay, that's good. I would do that. I will admit I have anxieties too, and sometimes they can be pretty strong and make me procrastinate on getting things done that I need to get done. They can be overpowering sometimes, so I can really understand that. Best I can tell you is just I have to get up in the morning sometimes and tell myself I have to do this. I've got to do this. And getting past that first step is the big thing. I would give you a little bit of encouragement in that go to the classes, go to the university, get your language training and whatnot, because we desperately need translators. Everybody's always asking about getting into the voice acting aspect of it, but there's an awful lot that goes on in the industry that you can do and be in the anime industry. And I will tell you, I'll give you a little encouragement right now. We need translators really badly because we've got so many shows coming out of Japan that we've got more work there than we have translators to do it. And so they've just got piles and piles of stuff. So conquer your fears. Go get into that school, start taking those classes, and get in touch with us. Send your resume in. Seriously. Because translators are really important.
But to add to what Joe said earlier, make sure that you learn the skill first. Don't take a semester and go, okay, I can start doing it. Because if you don't, you know what I mean? Make sure you master it, because then you'll be a champion for it. So.
I'm actually also from the Louisville area, and we're going to be starting a con here in the next couple of years, so I kind of wanted to see the flip side of that and ask you the question of, if you all were running a convention, what would you like to see in it?
If we were running a convention, what would we like to see?
Like programming and content-wise? Yeah.
Well, I could answer that, but maybe I should. I've actually just started to run a convention, so.
Well, I think we're all available to be guests there.
Yeah. I think the artists are the most important part. I think seeing the artists, and that's what it's really all about, people sharing their ideas, that the fact that this convention has all of these groups that people get together and talk, and it's about coming together and sharing. And so I think it starts with the artists, really.
You know, I did a convention in Chicago and I almost pulled this off. They didn't want to do it. But I wanted, because we had a bunch of actors, I wanted to have the fans write 5 minutes of fan fiction of their favorite anime and we perform it live on stage.
That would be awesome. That would be awesome.
Great idea.
Cold reads.
And I would do that in a New York minute.
Okay, now that you mention it, yeah. I thought it would be really cool. You know, a lot of times conventions are raise money for cancer research or diabetes or whatever, you know. And I thought it would be really, really cool to, on Thursday, or I guess you'd have to do it on Friday, but Friday, you have open auditions, and this is really weird, but it's to raise money. So you would actually pay $10 to come audition, and that money, all the money would go toward a charity, not in the pockets of the people running this, but the charity. But you come and audition for an anime, and you're doing one episode, and if you get cast, you record Friday night, and then you mix it, rough mix, and then you show it Saturday night in a room like this and charge $5 for people to get in, knowing that all that money goes to charity. But then anyone that, like, anyone who's got that aspiration, that dream, can come audition, and, you know, whether you get the lead role or you get Soldier B, you're in it. And A, you've just got yourself a credit, and also you've raised money for charity, and you've gotten to see what you look like on.
And if you bought the North American distribution rights, you've just cast it and shot it for nothing. And now you've made, now you're into the real money.
Yeah.
Hey, we're solving problems here.
So this is a question for everybody. What is your favorite anime or video game character?
Favorite anime or video game character? Bart Simpson?
That we've performed?
Oh, that we've been in? I wasn't Bart Simpson.
Well, I have a joke. Okay. Because this question came up years ago when we were starting, and I had a very small title. I can't even remember the name of the title. But there's the main characters, and then somebody just said, there was one character that showed up in the script that I thought was the most hilarious name. It was Follower A. So, Follower A is my favorite anime character. And the guy voiced it with some voice he had picked up from YouTube of a 60s comedian, like, I will be there in a minute. So to this day, I can't get Follower A out of my head.
No.
That's what it was, Dudley Do-Right. He used Dudley Do-Right as his voice thing.
Funny.
So it's like, Follower A is my hero.
Yeah.
And I'm here to bring him into public consciousness, if I could only remember the show in which Follower A appeared.
Yeah, that's if you want to get into voice acting too, let me give you a hint. This has been my saving grace in my career. I can do bad impressions. They're not good impressions. Like, I did a very bad Jack Nicholson, and it turned out to be a Monojaku in Ghost Stories. So if you can do, say, if I was an impressionist, I'd never get a day's work. But if I can do bad, like, I do a horrible Michael Caine, and that's been like four characters.
Hey,
This is my horrible Michael Caine, if you like to hear. No, Mr. Wayne, I won't watch you die. I won't do it.
Oh, that's good.
No, that's a horrible Michael
Caine. I like it.
The gal was only 17. She was only 17.
I don't have a specific, honestly, when I'm in the booth, recording, and this is from my first anime all the way up to last week or 2 weeks ago recording Attack on Titan Junior High. It's usually the other actors that I'm hearing. I mean, I think there are some really talented people that I get to listen to when I'm in a recording session, and I'm always asking, wait, who is that? Oh yeah, right, okay. So. Mine are less about characters and more about the people that I've gotten to be around and work with that have brought those characters to life.
And there was one thing, we do something called...
I'm sitting next to two of them. I mean, yeah. I was, my first anime ever, John Swayze was in, and he played this crazy little guy named Vulcan, who was just like amazing and awesome. And I was like, wow, that's awesome, I want to do that. And then this dude plays in Super Milk Chan. What was the name of that guy?
No, he was the landlord.
He was just the landlord. If you want a good laugh, go get that and watch it. But anyway.
It's a dead-on impression of the director. It's actually a bad impression of the director.
Yeah.
But I was going to say, one of my favorite, when we do something called Walla, which is background noise, like in a big group of people, you see a big crowd, and we say things and they end up in the background and you never really hear them, it just sounds like noise, and that's called Walla. And I had a standing battle with another voice actor named Mike McCray. They said Walla, so I would insult Mike McCray in the Walla. I would do these disgusting sexual acts that he was committing on people. And he heard it one time, he goes, hey man, what is he doing? And so he did it to me one time. It's like, Rob Mungle, and so we had this go for like 16 different movies. It's Mike McCray's and Rob Mungle's battle over the most vile sexual act.
So what you do is get some software, bring everything else down, and bring up the Walla volume-wise and listen to all that.
Actually, it's hysterical.
One of my favorite things like that, we were doing the live-action movie Gamera And there's one scene in there where they, towards the beginning of the movie, and they come up on a boat to this island, and they get off on the island, and they start, the island's actually Gamera's back. And Doug Smith was one of our artists, and he would do a lot of Walla. He did Golden Boy. He was Golden Boy in there. But yeah. He, in the background, and the thing is we took this way down so that it was just in with the Walla, but we actually left it up enough that you can actually hear it. So if you're watching HBO, because this, or any of the channels, that are, the movie gets shown a lot. He's, as all these people are climbing out of the boat, and they're going up onto Gamera's back, he's doing Grandpa Simpson's voice, and he's going, "Turtle's got my teeth." And that, we left it in there so you can actually hear it, but you gotta listen real carefully
and,
at the right point.
And Gamera 2, Kyle Jones directed it, and we did a version of it as a bunch of Texas rednecks. And we literally went in the studio a couple days with beer and pizza and just started making up lines. But we kept Shelley Black, who was the lead female. We just left her normal audio track, so the storyline continued. But there's great lines in there, like, "Man, that's a big ass turtle." But my favorite one is Kyle Jones recorded it, and it's like the Wilhelm scream. You know that, the Wilhelm scream? And yeah, and it's in there, and he just goes, "Holy crap!" And we just put that in, I think it's like 18 times in the movie. And we tried to make it a drinking game, you know, every time you hear, you gotta take a drink or something. And anyway, that was very funny.
We have 5 more minutes left, just so you know. So we'll zoom through some questions and try to get everything in.
Okay, wait.
Hi, I'm back. I have a question about auditions. As actors, do you typically find work on your own or through your agents? Or I remember in your panel you said something about with Pokemon, you got it from the company they bought Pokemon that you were already working for.
So that would have been on my own through a recommendation.
Right. So what is the most effective
agents
way
are the devil.
I have agents and on my own. I think a lot of it is networking. It's who you know, who you've worked with. Will they ask you to audition again? I get a lot of work on my own that way and then through my agent. I need an agent, but I get a lot of work on my own.
I think people think that when you're starting out and you get your first agent, that somehow, oh great, I'm on my way. And that's just not really the truth at all.
But it gives you a legitimacy that you need, but you still can't stop working
for yourself.
It does,
because it does do that.
It's definitely necessary.
But we're all with the same agent, let's say, okay? And we're all going to audition for this role. Agent doesn't care if David gets it, or Rob gets it, or David gets it, or Joe gets it, or, you know, it doesn't matter to them, because as long as one of us gets it, they get their commission. Whereas we're all like there to beat each other out of the job. Right. So you need an agent, but like I never, I got ADV, and all the anime work I do, I got on my own.
Every right. job I've ever gotten, I've gotten on my own.
Anime doesn't usually go through an agent. Anyway.
Right, and the best scenario you can have is you have an agent and you're also out there doing your own work and you're trying to get your own work. If that's self-submissions online, if that's meeting people and handing them a business card, whatever that is. And then, I've had many situations where my agent will call me and say, "Hey, so-and-so called and wants to book you for blah, blah, blah," and that was because I made that contact. And that makes your agent really, really happy.
Mm-hmm. Bill Murray doesn't have an agent.
And that's what I was talking about earlier. True. The work is finding the job.
Right.
You know, so you could,
all of the people that we've brought in and all, we have gone through a few agents occasionally, but 99.9% of it has all been recommendations. They will come up and they'll say, I know this person's got a really good voice, you should try them out for something. And we'll bring them in and audition them and whatnot. So we, in the anime industry, it's pretty much all.
I know what I was gonna say, I'll say this real quick, but I promise you, if you wanna be a voice actor, I promise you, somebody out there thinks you have the perfect voice. You gotta go find them, because they're not gonna find you.
Right.
You gotta go find them.
I think so. You're always networking.
I always tell people, network, because not just with the voice acting, but anything, because we've hired more people that I have met at conventions to come work for us, just because they come up, they introduce themselves to everybody, they've talked about, you know, what their skills or their interests were, and then at some point down the road, we're around the office, we need somebody who can do this, and I'm like, hey, I remember this person, that let me get in touch with them. And we've actually hired a lot of fans that we've met at the convention.
I'll just give you my card.
Okay.
You know, there are some, I was at a convention over the New Year's weekend and had fans and also art, who were artists, bring some of their art to me. And, you know, some of it was so amazing that if I ever have a chance to refer somebody, I'm gonna pull out that work and their cards that they gave me. You know, it was sort of a dual thing. It was a gift, but it was also, it was marketing. It was business, you know?
Yeah, business cards or buying the North American distribution rights are two of the best ways to break into the industry.
We have a last question, maybe? Let's go quickly. You and then you over here, right? Go ahead.
We come from a university where acting's really popular. What advice would you give to acting students for the different type of auditions?
For the different, you mean if you're auditioning for animation or voiceover, audiobook, theater?
Yes.
I think it's all the same. You approach it character. Build your character. You have to, whatever it is, if you're playing a sheep or an old lady or a boy or you're narrating 10 characters in a book, it's character. So you have to be that character. Find the truth
in
it.
Any acting, any voice work, anything, in a nutshell, in my opinion, it has to come from here. It has to be real. If it's not, it's fake, and it sounds fake, and will not be looked upon well.
And confidence. Like, confidence is king. If you, even if you're worried and scared, walk into a room and believe in yourself. You know, even if you bomb that, that will be remembered, because most people don't.
And be nice.
Yes, be easy to work with, because there are a lot of people coming in and out, and the ones who are easiest to work with, who don't interrupt, who don't apologize every time they read a line. Oh, I'm sorry. You don't have to be sorry.
Yeah, because we're not just looking at the voice generally. We're also looking at, can they take direction?
Yeah, right. You have to be able to take direction. You have to go with the flow. You have to be respectful of the situation. The situation is that there's a limited budget. There's a limited amount of time. Everybody's got to get their work done as well as possible within that. So being a cooperative personality is key in addition to the talent.
And that,
as a matter of fact, the talent
lot.
Is a given. These personal attributes are actually more important in a way, because if you're a great actor who's difficult to work with, you're not going to get work. It's just not going to happen.
Screw it. Rent a theater and put on your own play.
Right. Unless you do what he said, and then you have nothing to worry about.
Yeah.
That's right.
Cut out the middleman. That's what I'm saying.
Cut out the middleman. This question, last question.
Okay, is this working? Okay. How do you deal with the snobby attitude or whatever with actors that I see, or from certain people, from directors and stuff, that sometimes deal with actors that are very snobby, or they think they're too good to be voice acting in this rom-com slice of life anime that's probably the 20th thing that came out of the year or whatever. And I just want to know how you deal with actors like that, or if you know any actors or whatever that are starting to go through this type of attitude or whatever.
So what happens when an actor has an attitude that they're too good for it, or people are over it, or too sarcastic?
You generally don't hire them.
I buy the North American distribution rights to their movies and fire them.
Actually, from the music business, I have to say, I learned very young watching some major league producers. Let's say a musician is hired, and the analogy is exactly the same. The musician is absolutely great, and he won't listen to anything the producer says, and he eats food out of the refrigerator. When the producer is always nice, shakes their hand and says, thank you so much, I'm so glad you came into the session, and he never gets another call. And this is why I say, think about your attitude, because nobody's gonna tell you that you're a pain in the ass.
They're
just not gonna hire you.
You see the same actors, if you watch different television shows, you'll see a lot of the same actors being hired. And it's not favoritism or anything like that. It literally is because they are good to work with. They deliver the goods. They're pleasant to be around. They're focused.
Right. They're keeping the machinery running, because it's a very expensive endeavor.
The higher it gets, the more money is involved. If I'm producing something, I can't take a risk on somebody who is going to delay that or cost me a ton of money. You know.
Ultimately, though, for all of us personally, if you're not doing what you love and it can make you happy, there's really no point in doing that, because you're wasting your energy and you're putting out that, you know, we all are that drop in the pond and our energy ripples out. So if your ripple is so negative, you might as well change that. So I think most of us are lucky enough to not have to work with people who are so sarcastic and over it, because we love what we do. And hopefully for all of us, we can continue to be that positive force in the world.
Yeah, and I think gratitude. You gotta continue. Once you stop being grateful for what you have, it usually will create bitterness. If you think that you should be doing more or whatever, and you're not present, you're not grateful for what you have. And that's the way to start the path toward that attitude problem, you know?
And that ends our panel with all of you. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with us. This is wonderful. We all have other panels and we're doing signings, so hope to see you soon.